Okay. Bonjour, bienvenue, mesdames et messieurs. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. Buonasera, benvenuto. Buenas tardes, señoras y señores. Guten Abend, Herren und Frauen. Welcome, Sie. 여러분, 안녕하십니까? 환영합니다. My name is Sungun Kim. I'll be your host for this event. In case you're wondering, this is not the opening ceremonies for the 24th Winter Olympics, but if you are here for the International Civil Aviation Organization's 13th Air Navigation Conference, then you're at the right place. Like I said, I'd like to welcome those who came from near and far. I hope that you leave here a little bit wiser and that you make a lot of business contacts, that you improve current relations, that you make new ones, and that you take the time after the event to sample some of, of our greatest food in this part of the world. I'd like to also remind you that we're coming to you live and that we should thank all those who are make this experience possible. Now, let me introduce to you our first speaker, who is a homegrown talent. His over 15-year career is comprised of experience at Air Canada, IATA, and ICAO. He studied here also. Not only that, which means that not only does he have hands-on practical experience, but he also understands marketing and the legislative part of his business. He is our guru, responsible for all of ICAO's activities in the field of cabin safety, and will present the topic of GASP, which is the Global Aviation Safety Plan. Without further much ado, please welcome ICAO Safety and Efficiency Officer, Mr. Martin Maurino.
And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As mentioned, I'm Martin, technical officer here at ICAO, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our Global Aviation Safety Plan. So, if you're familiar, what is the Global Aviation Safety Plan? Maybe this works a bit better. There we go. So, if you're not familiar, what is the Global Aviation Safety Plan? It's really our document which houses the ICAO strategy on how to enhance safety at the international level. In there, we have specific targets and initiatives aimed at states, aimed at regional entities, and aimed at industry. And the idea is that the GASP presents the strategy at the global level, and that gets translated at a regional level and then at a state level through what we call regional and national safety aviation plans, which contain the strategy for a particular region or for an individual state. The idea is that because we have this three-tier approach, where we're looking at safety initiatives across different states and also with industry and working collaboratively together, we are actually promoting harmonization of the different efforts that are aimed at improving safety, and we're also reducing duplication of efforts as well. So how is the GASP developed and updated? It's done through a very comprehensive process, which includes a lot of collaboration and consultation. From an internal ICAO perspective, we have two main groups that we deal with. The first one I'll talk to you a little bit about afterwards, but it's the GASP study group, the group of experts to develop the GASP, and also our Air Navigation Commission establishes a group which is called the Ad Hoc Working Group on the GASP, which actually goes through all the work that's being developed here internally before it's sent out to states. Last year, we held what we called the SANIS, that's the Safety and Air Navigation Implementation Symposium, and it was a chance to present a rough draft of the GASP, as well as a proof of concept of where we were going for the next 10 years or so in the 2020-22 edition. And at that point, we had a lot of feedback already at this symposium from states and from industry, giving us good feedback that we're actually on the right direction. We then went through a consultation process with states and international organizations. So in preparation for the conference that's happening here in Montreal this week, we send out a state letter, and we also send out a questionnaire where we ask states specific questions about the GASP, how they use it, what their challenges are, what else they'd like to see in there, and we will include all that as part of the revision. We had very good replies. We had 75 states and international organizations in total that replied. By ICAO standards, that's actually a very good return rate, and we're taking all that feedback on board now for the next edition. That brings us to this week's 13th Air Navigation Conference. In tomorrow's session, we will discuss the GASP, and we'll hear also from states and from international organizations in terms of what feedback and what suggestions they have to improve the plan. After the conference, we will take in all this feedback, and our Air Navigation Commission will once again do a review of the document with any proposed changes coming out of the conference. Afterwards, it will then go out to Council. Our ICAO Council approves the document, so it'll be for them to approve once they deem that it's ready. And we will then do another round of state consultations. So there will be a working paper that's sent out to all member states and international organizations in preparation for our General Assembly, which will happen next year. And at that point, the GASP will be once again discussed at the Assembly, and at that point endorsed as per any changes. And that will make the document live. So as you can see, we go through a lot of steps. It's not a plan that's done in-house at ICAO, but that's really done in consultation. As I mentioned, we have a study group, which is the GASP study group. And that is a group made up of subject matter experts from states in all regions, and also from international organizations representing different parts of aviation. You can see the logos on the slide on screen. And this is the study group that has actually developed all of the content that you'll see in the GASP. They work through a process of consensus, and it's joint industry regulatory. So we took all their advice and their expertise in determining the goals, the targets, what are the issues, what are the challenges, how we can best help states and industry. And it is through their work that we actually managed to produce the next GASP. The study group working on the development looked at some basic principles that we thought we should consider for the next edition of the GASP. And this also takes into account the experience from past GASPs and also feedback received in previous editions as well. The first thing that the group decided is that it's important for the plan to have a very clear vision of where we're going, to also have a clear mission, what do we want to do, and some key values that are underlining or enabling in order to have a successful plan. The group also decided that it was important to structure the plan into different parts. You'll notice that there's a part that is aimed at how to develop a plan and another part at how to implement it. And there's also an executive summary that is aimed at director generals of civil aviation and other senior management personnel, because it was the group's opinion that it was important to not only speak to the technical officers or inspectors at the state level, but also to get the buy-in from senior management. We also needed to clearly delineate responsibilities. So what is the expectation from ICAO? What is the expectation from an individual state? At the regional level, we have some key players like the regional aviation safety groups or regional safety oversight organizations. So their roles need to be defined. And also, what is industry's role, whether it's an international organization or individual service providers? We also decided to take a structure that mirrors what is in the UN Sustainable Development Goals, and that is to use the terms goals, targets, and indicators to replace objectives. And we also created what's called an aspirational goal, so where we really want to go with the plan. We also agreed to have a risk-based approach. So we know that states do not have infinite amount of resources to address safety issues, so there has to be some kind of risk-based assessment that's done. And that will carry through to what we call the high-risk categories of occurrences, which I'll talk to you a little bit about later, and how we look at what types of accidents or what precursors we want to focus on in terms of safety. And we received a lot of good feedback for what we call the Global Aviation Safety Roadmap. So the group agreed that it was important to make this more predominant in the actual GASP, because it's really the path for how to implement and achieve the GASP goals. So I mentioned we have an aspirational goal. Our aspirational goal is the goal of zero fatalities. So we say it's aspirational because we know that this is a hard goal to reach. Some states do it. They can go decades without a fatal accident. Regions do it as well. But it is a hard goal. However, it represents what we are striving for in safety. In safety, our goal is to protect passengers, to protect crew, and to make sure that nobody is subject to a fatality because they're taking air transport. So that is a way to give a clear message that this is the end goal that we're aiming for in terms of safety. Now, I mentioned we have a GASP vision. And our vision is to achieve and maintain the goal of zero fatalities That is our aspirational goal in commercial operations by 2030 and beyond. We picked 2030 because this is when we expect traffic will double. So we need to make sure that safety keeps up with the growing volume. And also this aligns with the 2030 agenda for sustainable development at the higher UN level. And of course, in safety, we don't want to just reach a target. We want to keep going. So we added beyond, of course, hoping to maintain this in the years to come. The mission of the GASP is to enhance international aviation safety performance by providing a collaborative framework for states, regions, and industry. These are the three audiences we speak to, and we really want the GASP to be the framework for how a state will actually plan its safety-related activities and initiatives through a certain period of time. The values, I won't go through all of them because there are quite a few, but just to give you a bit of an idea of the sort of enablers that we felt were essential to have a successful GASP. Things like promoting a positive safety culture to make sure that aviation professionals are safety-minded in actually conducting their tasks. Promoting the sharing and exchange of safety information, because this is a very big part of having a safety management approach to safety. Taking data-driven decisions based on safety data. And prioritizing actions through a risk-based approach, as I mentioned before, because we know that states and even industry do not have infinite amount of resources, so we need to look at what are the key areas we want to address. So I mentioned there's an aspirational goal, and just to give you an idea of the structure of how we've structured the GASP, from this aspirational goal of having zero fatalities, we actually have some goals that we call organizational goals. So they relate to organizational challenges. And those are typically things like setting up a safety oversight system, having inspectors in place, having funds for the authority. These are organizational issues. Operational goals relate to operational safety risks. And that typically relates to dealing with accident categories and with hazards and risks. So with that in mind, we then have specific targets. Some address improving safety oversight at the state level. Some address safety management provisions and the implementation of state safety programs and safety management systems. And on the operational side, we have some targets which relate to reducing or addressing types of accidents and those that relate to addressing safety risks. So where we know there aren't accidents that happen very frequently, we have to look at the precursors and how we address those. And after that, we have a whole bunch of indicators, which I won't go through in detail, but we are used to actually measure whether or not the targets are being achieved and then whether the goals are being achieved. So as it stands in the draft GASP that will be presented to the conference, we have six proposed goals, so the overarching ones. The first one is to achieve a continuous reduction in the operational safety risks, and that's by addressing accident categories, particularly those that can lead to a lot of fatalities if they occur. The second goal is to strengthen the state safety oversight capabilities, because we know that that has an impact on how safety is affected at the state level. The third is to implement ICAO provisions regarding safety management, so that is specifically state safety programs at the state level, and also safety management systems for service providers. The fourth goal is to increase regional collaboration that ties in with regional entities such as the RAS that I mentioned, the regional aviation safety groups or oversight organizations. And it's addressed at looking at hazards and risks at the regional level and also states assisting each other, particularly to assist some of the states that are having difficulties with safety oversight or with complying with ICAO standards. The fifth goal relates to expanding the use of industry programs. So this one is really aimed at the industry part. And it looks at, for example, expanding programs such as IOSA, the IATA Operational Safety Audit, which has safety benefits, and also at looking at other aspects like having harmonized safety performance indicators for the different types of service providers. And the last one is our tie to the Global Air Navigation Plan, and that is a goal for states to have appropriate infrastructure to support safe operations. And that is mostly based on what we call the basic building blocks that are part of the Global Air Navigation Plan, and that is to have the correct infrastructure to enable safe operations. So I mentioned the high-risk categories of occurrences. So these are the types of accidents that, as a group, we came to a consensus were the most pressing to address. That was based on analysis, and it was based on looking at either the number of fatalities that have occurred based on these types of accidents in the past, or, since accidents don't happen very often, it was based on looking at what is the risk of fatalities. So if one of these accidents is to occur, would that entail multiple fatalities on board or on the ground. So the five that the study group came to as a consensus and that are presented in the plan are the following: runway excursions. Okay, and we know that they are not always fatal, but they can be, and they actually happen quite often statistically among accidents. Loss of control in flight, because we know that these usually result in multiple fatalities that are not survivable. Controlled flight into terrain, again, they do not happen very often, but if they do, they lead to multiple fatalities. Runway incursions, because collisions don't happen very often, but we know that there is a problem with incursions between aircraft, so we looked at that. And the last category is mid-air collisions. So again, we then only focus on number of accidents that happen, but for example, if there are air procs or level bus, which can indicate the potential for a mid-air collision, that could in effect result in multiple fatalities. So this is how we pick these categories. The idea is that although states might have different types of accidents they want to look at, they might want to add a few to these, may not have these happen often, they are considered of global concern. So at a state level and at the regional level, there should be some kind of action related to these categories, whether it's concrete actions or just monitoring to ensure that they're not actually happening. There should be something in the national and the regional safety plans to address them. So what are the next steps going forward? This is where the GASP is today. These are what's in the draft that will be discussed here at the conference. The draft itself is fully complete, so we've gone through the whole document. As I mentioned, the Air Navigation Commission already reviewed it and agreed to send it to the conference for their feedback. We will hear the discussions going on this week here at the conference. We'll hear from states and international organizations on their feedback on the GASP and where we're at with the document. As I mentioned, we had sent out a questionnaire and we received over 70 replies, so we will take into account all those comments, including initiatives that can be added to the GASP or supporting tools for implementation to assist states. We are also rolling out workshops, so at the regional level, with our regional offices, mainly at the regional aviation safety groups or other ICAO forums, we are doing workshops to help states understand what's in the next GASP, what's coming up, how to implement it, how to develop a national plan, how to align it with the goals that are in the GASP. And taking on all these different feedback, we will make modifications to the GASP from here on in preparation for the endorsement at the 40th session of the assembly, which will take place in the third quarter of next year. So if you do have any additional feedback and you'd like to send comments on the GASP, you can email them at gasp@icao.int. As I said, it's a very comprehensive process of collaboration, and we're always happy to get feedback from states, international organizations, industry, on ways we can improve the plan, make it more relevant, and also support implementation. So that concludes my presentation, and I'm happy to take any questions you might have. Thank you. No questions? All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, thank you once again, Mr. Martin Maurino. Okay, on to our next topic. Now, all of you know that it's common knowledge that each and every country has a way to identify, track, and therefore manage their own skies. But imagine being able to do it not only at a national level, but at a global level. Now, this seems something like out of an Avengers 4 movie, but there's a U.S. company called Aerion that has developed this technology and has started to implement its proprietary